The Northern California Time Trials. Anyway, he's the founder and director of the Nevada Center of Alternative and Anti-Aging Medicine in Carson City, Nevada, and attracts patients from all over the country. He's board certified in anti-aging medicine and has served as clinical instructor in family medicine at the University of California School of Medicine, Davis. He's an expert on mitochondrial function and human energy production. He's authored two books, Bursting with Energy. We still have five copies left there. Describes his work with measuring and improving mitochondrial function, preventing disease, increasing energy levels, and slowing aging. Also, the type 2 diabetes breakthrough, which is already sold out here, just recently released, describes how type 2 diabetes can be completely prevented and best treated by optimizing mitochondrial function. I give you Frank Schellenberger.
Glad I braved those busy highways. I want you to know, sometimes you go to hear a talk and it's not that important. Tonight's talk is obviously very important. They've given me two microphones just in case one didn't work. So your time will not be wasted tonight for sure. I was going to talk about diabetes and maybe you'll have me back and I will talk about that. It's a great topic, and I brought some of my diabetes books. I only had four left because fortunately, and kind of unfortunately, I guess, but it's already sold out of its first printing, and we're going into a second printing, so we don't even have any more left right now. But diabetes is a fantastic disease to look at that gives you, to give you an example, what the whole aging process is about. Because if you do what it takes to prevent diabetes, you're going to do what it takes to slow down the entire aging process. It's very interesting. So I hope you can at some point, take a look at that. But what happened was I was, asked a month or so ago, a little bit after I talked to Mike, to give a talk in Atlanta for doctors that specialize in cancer. And I thought, you know what, this is a really interesting topic. And so maybe you guys will like that too, because one of the major fears that we can have is getting cancer. I can pretty much promise my patients if they do what I tell them, I'll give them a money back guarantee. You're not going to get any disease, except I can't say that about cancer. And cancer is a really difficult disease to 100% prevent. But tonight I'm going to show you what I think comes the closest to preventing this disease of anything else I've come around with. We've been treating cancer for a while up at the clinic. We do believe very much in this kind of an approach, so that we always think that you have to treat the cancer. Now that's certainly the conventional oncological approach. Do some kind of treatment to the cancer. Slow it down, stop it, cut it out, burn it out, do something with it. So there's no doubt that you have to do that. The problem is that the conventional guys forget that there's a couple other factors going on here besides just this tumor that's living in your body. And not the least of which, when you treat any disease, ideally you would want to eliminate whatever caused that disease. And so that's something that we focus on, and that's really going to be the focus of the talk tonight, is what causes cancer and what can you do about it. And finally, lo and behold, conventional medicine more or less forgets that actually there's this disease here, but there's a patient with the disease. And so not only do we need to focus on the disease and the pathology associated with the disease and the disease process and the physiology and biochemistry of the disease, et cetera, but we also need to focus on the vitality and strength of the patient. A patient who's 65 years old and gets a disease is going to have a lot harder time dealing with that disease than if he were 30 years old and got the same disease, just due to his innate decrease in strength and vitality. So these are the three approaches that we really need to focus on when we treat any disease, but certainly with cancer. Do something about the disease, do something about the cause of the disease, and treat the overlying vitality and strength of the patient. In terms of treating the cancer, These are the kinds of things that we use at the clinic, and I often have to get help with this because I don't always do this kind of stuff, obviously. I don't do surgery. I don't do chemotherapy. I don't do radiation. But you got to do something to actually control the process of the cancer itself. What we do is a process called IPT, also known as insulin potentiation therapy. Good website if you want to learn about that is iptq.org. And I won't get into what that's all about, but it's a very good way to use homeopathic doses of chemotherapy and yet get the same killing, controlling effect as you do with the more toxic higher doses. And there are certain hormones that can be used for some of the hormone cancers of breast and prostate cancer. That's the treating the cancer part. I'm not really going to talk about that, but I thought I'd mention it. This is what we're really going to talk about. Treat the causes of cancer. And what the causes of cancer are: mitochondrial dysfunction, more mitochondrial dysfunction, and more mitochondrial dysfunction. Hope to convince you tonight that in your efforts to prevent cancer from occurring, or if you've already had cancer, in your efforts to prevent it from reoccurring, or if you currently have cancer and under treatment, in your efforts to get a better treatment for it, treat your mitochondria. That's going to be the whole message for tonight. That's a great slide. Let's pass on that. And then lastly, treat the patient. Now, the first thing on treating the patient is mitochondria. I don't know if you guys know what mitochondria are, so I'll take a little sidestep here on this. Does anybody know what mitochondria are?
Nobody knows.
Oh, okay. Well, just look. Just treat them, all right? I'll break this down in a little bit more detail, both for the lay people, so you have a sense of this, and also for the others that are, you know, more scientifically inclined or knowledgeable about it. But in each one of your cells, with the exception, I think, of red blood cells, in each one of the cells in your body are these little units called mitochondria. Some cells have 300 of them per cell. Some cells have 3,000 of them per cell. What they do is they charge your batteries. You guys are like flashlights, okay? You're like a flashlight with a rechargeable battery. And what recharges your batteries is you convert oxygen to carbon dioxide. So you've got this flashlight, oxygen's coming into the flashlight, and carbon dioxide's going out of the flashlight. Now, oxygen's a very high energy molecule. It's one of the highest in the universe. Carbon dioxide's a much lower energy molecule. So as this goes through the flashlight, as the high energy molecule goes in, low energy molecule goes out, what's getting released? Energy. And that energy is getting stored in your batteries so that your light can shine. That's happening in every cell in your body. Now you can imagine what would happen to a battery if you couldn't charge, happen to a flashlight, if you couldn't charge the batteries very well. The light starts getting dim. And that's basically the aging process. The light gets dimmer, and then it goes out. The intrinsic thing that's behind all of that is how well you can charge up your mitochondria, how well you can take that oxygen, convert it to carbon dioxide, charge up your batteries. By the way, the name of the battery is a molecule called ATP. That's the battery's name. And it's called adenosine triphosphate. I'll probably mention that somewhere in here. But in each one of your mitochondria, there's all this ATP. And it's constantly getting charged up, constantly getting energy dumped into it. And then it can just sit around there with all this energy. And then next time your cell needs to do something, whatever that is, 60% of the cellular use of ATP simply goes to maintaining the membrane potential of the cell. In other words, so you don't collapse. You know that you're mostly space, right? And if we took all the space out of you, we could put you in a thimble or something, I don't know, but it's something like that, right? And what maintains this space is ATP. So if you didn't have any ATP, what are you going to do? You're going to shrink in, and this indeed is ultimately the process that's involved with getting older and finally dying. So we want to charge the batteries. We want to look at those batteries. The whole life process is based upon those batteries, and that's in the mitochondrial part of the cell. We'll talk a little bit more about it. But you can, what we'll learn tonight is that in order to prevent cancer, you want to improve your mitochondrial function, because cancer is innately caused by a decreased ability to charge that battery. That's what causes it. Secondly, to treat the strength and vitality of the patient, you want to get their mitochondrial function up to par, because that's what their immune system depends on. That's what their mental thoughts, everything depends on. Their whole vitality depends on that. The other thing that we do to treat the patient, besides treating the mitochondrial function, is to treat the adrenal status. I won't spend a lot of time with this, but I will tell you that every single patient that has any disease has seriously impaired adrenal activity. And if a physician doesn't aggressively treat that, and very often it's not aggressively enough treated, this patient will not do so well. Certainly, cancer is a classic example of patients who are completely exhausted from the adrenal perspective. There are certain nutraceuticals, vitamins, minerals, and such like that to help patients. Hormones are very big. The difference between you at the age of 70 and you at the age of 30 is mostly hormones. Constitutional homeopathics, we use that a lot in the clinic. Exercise is at the top of the list. We, not too long ago, looked at a comparison study of all the patients that we measured mitochondrial function on, and as we go on through the talk, you'll learn that what we do in the clinic is measure mitochondrial function, which seems reasonable since I'm telling you it's so important. What we should measure it, so we do that. And we looked at groups of patients in their 70s. We particularly picked that decade because 70s is really where your mitochondria start to go to pot. Up until the late 60s, early 70s, anything's possible. You can normally turn any train around. Starting to get around that age bracket, though, the mitochondria literally become destroyed and things start to become irreversible. So that seemed like a pretty good decade to look at. So we took 70-year-olders, and we took quite a few of them, a little over 100. And we looked at the ones that we had done the mitochondrial function on, and we had done it a second time, and it really improved. And then we looked at the ones where we did it a second time and didn't get much better at all. And we divided them, those two, into two groups, and then we studied all the charts. And we said, well, why are the guys that, what did we do with these guys that got better? And what did we do with the guys that didn't get better? What's the difference here? Anybody want to guess what the biggest single difference overwhelmingly was between those two groups?
Exercise.
It was exercise. Now, being a molecularly inspired physician, I was sure it was going to be hormones or vitamins or something, but it wasn't. It was exercise. So exercise is very important for all of us. And then the other side of exercise, the flip side of that coin, is rest. Okay, so cancer is a mitochondrial disease, and I hope to show you that now. Anybody in here heard of Otto Warburg? Otto Warburg, a couple of people. Okay, that's good. Otto Warburg is probably the greatest scientific mind of the 20th century. Some would argue Einstein, some might argue Linus Pauling, but probably Otto Warburg would get that, because he's the only man in history that has won two Nobel Prizes in medicine. Amazing man. He was a German physiologist as well as a medical doctor, and he ran what is now known as the Max Planck Institute in Germany of physiology and cellular medicine. He wrote a book called The Metabolism of Tumors, which was translated in 1931, which is when he did most of his work demonstrating very clearly what I'm about to be talking to you about most of tonight. And then he wrote another book in 1962, published, called New Methods of Cell Physiology. And he was something like 68 when he wrote that book. So he was very productive right until the end. Warburg proved that the fundamental difference between normal cells and cancer cells, and this is the main thing, was that cancer cells relied on non-mitochondrial energy production, whereas normal cells rely on mitochondrial energy production. We'll talk a little bit more about why that is. So it seems to reason that if you don't want to get cancer, let's keep your mitochondrial energy production going. if you want to get cancer, let's try and shut it down and develop non-mitochondrial forms of energy production. He also wrote The Prime Cause and Prevention of Cancer, which he presented in a lecture to some other Nobel Prize laureates in June of 1966. And in this speech, Warburg literally proved that anaerobic metabolism, that's the kind of metabolism that occurs without mitochondria, the kind of energy production that is non-mitochondrial, to be the primary cause of cancerous cells. So that's kind of the gist of my talk right there. I'm going to present a few papers here that kind of show you that. I always like to show papers and references when I'm giving a talk so that people understand this is just not my opinion. I didn't think this up. I'm just more or less a reporter. And I'm giving you a report on what is now known out there that you probably don't hear much about. Because probably nobody in here ever heard anybody say cancer is caused by poor mitochondrial function. But there's plenty in the literature to substantiate this. Now, this is a review article from 2005. It's entitled Mitochondria and Cancer, Warburg Addressed. What the authors in this paper suggest or demonstrate is that cancer cells generate excessive lactate in the presence of oxygen. Now, I'm going to explain that in a sec, so don't worry about it. That basically is the definition of anaerobic metabolism. Cancers generate, when they're in the presence of oxygen, those cells choose not to use it. They choose instead to make energy anaerobically with this huge production of lactic acid. There are two reasons that cells do this. One is that they have an increased shift from fat to glucose metabolism. Now, look at it this way. This is what happens in your mitochondria. Again, each cell having hundreds of these things. Fat goes into the mitochondria. Glucose goes into the mitochondria. And oxygen goes into the mitochondria. The oxygen can burn the fat, or the oxygen can burn the glucose. And in the process of one of those two things, energy is made and your batteries get recharged. ATP is made and your batteries get recharged. So oxygen can either burn fat or glucose. The preferable form of energy production, the one that's the healthiest, the one that you do best in 20-year-old athletes, and as they get to be 50 years old, they don't do so well, is fat metabolism. Now, when I went to medical school, that's not what they told me. They told me that the preferable, most usual sort of metabolism is glucose metabolism. You nutritionists, maybe physiologists, know what I'm talking about. That is more or less the dictum. Healthy cells burn glucose. That's 100% wrong. Healthy cells burn fatty acids. As they become unhealthy, they shift away from that. They're no longer able to burn fat so well. I'm going to show you why in a second. And they start shifting over to burning more and more glucose until ultimately they get to the point where I measure a lot of my patients. They don't burn any fat at all. They only burn glucose. Now, as you start to think about the implications of that, well, what happened to a person that didn't burn fat at all? He'd probably gain some weight, wouldn't he? And what happens as we get older and out of shape? There is that shift. We start having more and more fat. And that's one of the primary reasons, that little shift. So this shift is going on in all of us. What's interesting is that using some of the technology I'm going to talk to you about tonight, we can measure that shift. So I can tell you if you're burning fat optimally or if you're not burning fat optimally. But one of the main causative factors that turns cells towards this anaerobic metabolism that causes them to develop, turn into cancer, is this shift away from fat metabolism to more and more over-relying to glucose metabolism. And secondly, a decrease in the actual function of the mitochondria. We're going to discuss this in a sec so it makes more sense to you. Here's the kicker on this. Both of these are common events. I measure this in every single patient that comes in my office. I'll show you a study we just did. And I can tell you that these are common events even in young, asymptomatic people. So this is going on right now with many, many people. While they feel great and they're young and everything's wonderful, they're already having decreased mitochondrial function and shifting from fat to glucose already. As you get older, both those things get worse and worse, which is why, as you get older, there's an increased chance of getting cancer. Now, this is how it does it. By by these two factors causing anaerobic metabolism, what happens, how they end up causing cancer, is that this anaerobic metabolism results in increased ROS. ROS means reactive oxygen species. It's a fancy name for free radical molecules. You guys probably know about them. So free radical molecules then mutate what is called proto-oncogenes. These are genes that occur in the nucleus of a cell. They cause mutations in those proto-oncogenes, which initiates the cell cancer, turns that cell into a cancer cell. Secondly, that's not all. Then once the cell turns cancer, you've got to promote it. You've got to make it grow more. And ROS do that too. ROS, they drive nuclear replication, which is the promotion. So free radicals induce the cancer to become, the cell to become cancerous, and then promote it to go on to become a very successful cancer. And that's how Warburg described in 1931 how we cause cancer. This slide might look a little intimidating. I erased a lot of the stuff that used to be on it, actually, to make it less intimidating. But suffice it to say, if the slide itself is a cell, and this is the mitochondria, here's what's going on. Here's glucose, and here's fat, and there's oxygen. So what happens is that glucose can go into the cell, go through this cycle called the Krebs cycle, interact with oxygen, and create energy. Or fat can go into the cell, go through the Krebs cycle, interact with oxygen, and create energy. The thing that is different about glucose, remember I told you that as long as we're doing it this way, this is the healthy way. Everything's pretty good. Okay? Why is that? Because when we do glucose, a funny thing starts to happen. And that is not all of it goes this way. So when, in for example, sitting right now, in the chair right now, if you guys were at the top of your game, 80% of this, 80% of your energy right now would be coming from fatty acids. Okay? Now, a wager, just this is a good wager, it's a good bet, that probably 30% of you are having no energy from fat right now as we sit here. Instead of 80% of your energy coming from fat, 100% is coming this way because you are made that shift. And then a lot of the rest of you is somewhere in between. You know, you may be 60%, you may be 50%, you may be 70%. But as you make this shift towards this, what's going to happen is glucose certainly can go this way, but it can also go this way. And that's the difference between fat and glucose. You notice glucose can make energy outside of the mitochondria. So when I start talking about dysfunctional mitochondria, mitochondria that don't work so well, where are you going to get your energy from? If the mitochondria don't work so well, you can't burn fat at all. Fat can only be burned through the mitochondria. You got to go this way. Now, when you go with glucose, sure, if you're healthier than heck, and it all can go, that would be great, but it just doesn't. That's the problem. It just doesn't. A large portion of this molecule, glucose, goes this way. This is called anaerobic metabolism. It's a way to make energy without any oxygen at all. If you hold your breath, after about 30 to 45 seconds, pretty much all the oxygen in your system is gone. If you didn't have this in that instance, you would just fall over dead, end of story. But because you have the ability to make some energy, even in the absence of oxygen, you get to live for a while after you hold your breath. And this is why nature developed or evolved this particular mechanism, so that if you were drowning or an animal was choking you or, you know, there's a forest fire and you couldn't breathe or something, you had an emergency out. You can't do this forever, of course, because after 3 or 4 minutes you'll die by holding your breath. But you do get a little time to get out of harm's way. Glucose, if it's going this way, as you're shifting from fat to glucose metabolism, what's going to happen is you're going to start doing more and more of this. That goes along with the shift. This is the anaerobic metabolism that constitute what cancers live. That's what Warburg said. This is where cancers live. Cancers can't do this. They have dysfunctional mitochondria. Once your body shifts from fat to glucose metabolism, you're going to have more of this. And then the final nail in the coffin is, when this doesn't even work very well. So remember, there's two causes. There's the shift from fat to glucose. It's cause number one. Second cause is mitochondrial dysfunction. Now this doesn't, now you only do this. Now you only do that. And as your cells get closer and closer to this, that's what's going to cause them to develop cancer. All this is going to make sense in a little bit. All right, here's a study that very recently published, just this last January. It's called induction of oxidative metabolism. That means your mitochondria. And when you induce oxidative metabolism, you're causing your mitochondria to work better, okay? By mitochondrial frataxin, okay, that's just a substance that if you put it on cells, it makes those cells upregulate their mitochondria, so mitochondria work better. So here's what they did. They took cancer cells. Well, first of all, the authors note that cancer cells exhibit multiple alterations in mitochondrial content, in the structure of the mitochondria, the function and the activity of the mitochondria, basically what Warburg said many, many years ago. What the researchers did then is they overexpressed this protein in a bunch of different colon cancer lines. And what that caused is that caused each one of those colon cancers to have increased mitochondrial function. Whoops. What are we doing here? We're taking cells with very poor mitochondrial function and artificially increasing the mitochondrial function. So what do you think is going to happen? Consistent with Warburg's hypothesis, these cells, this is what happened to them when you increase their mitochondrial metabolism. This is what happens to cancer cells. They have decreased growth rates. They have increased doubling times. Hey, that's the definition of a good cancer therapy, right there. They have inhibited colony formation capacity. In other words, they can't metastasize. I like that part too. They have a reduced capacity for tumor formation when injected into new mice. So not only do these cells can't grow as well, not only do they slow down their growth and take a much longer time to double and reproduce, but when you take them and inject them into mice, a lot of the times they don't even produce a tumor. The authors then finish up with the study by saying that these results support the view that an increase in oxidative metabolism, that means improving your mitochondrial function. Now, I want to get personal here, because a lot of you guys don't have good mitochondrial function. Okay? So by improving your mitochondrial function, inhibits cancer growth in mammals. This is some powerful stuff, and I want you to know there's a lot of studies like this. These are just sort of the best of the best. This one is called alteration of bioenergetic phenotype of mitochondria is a hallmark of breast, gastric, lung, and esophageal cancer. Last time you saw colon cancer, now we're seeing this. Mitochondrial function is depressed in all cancers, according to the reviewers in this study, studied so far, including breast cancer. And then the authors go on to say, the findings reported in the present paper, in addition to previous findings in liver, kidney, and colon carcinoma, strongly suggest that altered bioenergetic function of mitochondria, decreased mitochondria, is a hallmark of carcinogenesis, as was hypothesized by Warburg almost 80 years ago. Now, let's take it a little bit further. If we take cells that are cancer cells and improve their mitochondrial function, and they become less cancerous and less malignant, if we take cells that aren't cancer cells and decrease their mitochondrial function and they become cancerous, that's already pretty interesting. This text is sort of the next logical step forward. What if you take a cell that's cancerous and you sort of improve it a little bit so its mitochondrial function is a little better, but it's still cancerous? Might not that make it a little less malignant? And in fact, there's a one-to-one relationship here. What these guys did is they compared breast cancer cells to normal cancer cells, okay? What they noticed, you guys are still going to get the gist of this already now, is that in the breast cancer cells, there was a 37% decrease in ATP. Remember, that's their batteries. 30% decrease in mitochondrial function there. And an 83% decrease in phosphocreatine, which is another enzyme I won't get into, but is also determined by this action that the mitochondria make that up. So there's a marked decrease in mitochondrial function in the breast cancer cells. Well, that's not too shocking. And they just go on to say, suggest impaired mitochondrial metabolism in breast cancer carcinoma cell lines. Well, we know that now. But here's the interesting part. They then compared of the cancer cells, they said, well, here's some regular cancer cells. Here's cancer cells that come from metastatic breast cancer. Are there any differences between the mitochondrial function? Sure there were. The cancer cells, the regular breast cancer cells, had a 50% reduction in mitochondrial function, but the metastatic cells had a 90% reduction. So what I'm telling you is not only does mitochondrial dysfunction cause cancer, the worse it is, the worse the cancer. So anything you can do to improve your mitochondrial function, anything, will decrease your chance of getting cancer. If you get cancer, in spite of taking that measure, it will decrease the chance the cancer would have been as malignant as it would have been had you not done that. If you are treating cancer, it's very important to pay attention to the mitochondrial function in your body and improve that. Okay, so a little bit of review. So we got a shift from fat metabolism to glucose metabolism. And we got decreased mitochondrial function causing these alterations that Warburg talked about. Just how common is this? This is the equipment that I use in the clinic. This is a test I call bioenergy testing that's described in my book. This is an analyzer. It does two things. It analyzes how much oxygen goes into your body and how much carbon dioxide comes out. But you can now understand that's pretty important to know. I'm measuring how well you can recharge your battery. We do this with you resting and with you on an exercise bicycle. So there's the guy resting, there's the thing in his mouth, tube going into the analyzer, measuring how much oxygen is disappearing into his body at a resting state. Now in a resting state, he should be making like at least 70% of his energy from fat. Now we can tell this by the ratio of oxygen to carbon dioxide. Then we move him over to the bike. We say, well, what's the maximum output of mitochondria? Let's just work this guy and see how well those babies can crank out battery fluid. And that's what we do. The test is really easy to do. It's safe, and we can do it on kids. We can do it on anybody, really. What I did is I defined this thing called early onset mitochondrial dysfunction, because what I discovered in doing this test was I get a 14-year-old kid that had mitochondrial dysfunction. I can get 30-year-old people that have mitochondrial dysfunction. I mean, this blew my mind, because if you look at the general literature, it's not supposed to happen until you hit 60 or 70. But that's just not the way it is. So I developed this term, early onset mitochondrial dysfunction. And what it refers to is a measurable decrease in ATP production, i.e. mitochondrial function. It does commonly occur in the young and increases in incidence as you get older. It's different from what they call mitochondrial decay. So in the anti-aging literature, there's this thing called mitochondrial decay. Mitochondrial decay is when the mitochondria are actually dead. They're gone. And they're not working very well. They're not working at all. And I was saying that that's what starts to happen to us as we hit our late 60s and early 70s. These things actually start dying off. Unless you're doing something to stop it, by the way. Plenty you can do to stop it, but unless you're doing something to stop it, they actually start to die. And in anti-aging literature, that's called mitochondrial decay. I'm talking about something that's different. Because EOMD is reversible. Mitochondrial decay isn't. And it occurs long before mitochondrial decay, and long before any signs of aging or degenerative disease. I'm telling you, healthy young people can show this. And the only way you know it's there is if you're looking for it. And if you're a physician and you're not measuring the mitochondrial function of your patients, you're not going to know it's there. When you might say, well, how come Warburg came up with this 80-some-odd years ago, and all this stuff is in the literature, and my doctor doesn't tell me about this, and my oncologist doesn't tell me about that, and I didn't read about it in Let's Live, and what's up with this? The reason is, because until recently, until we developed this technology to measure mitochondrial function, your doctor couldn't measure it. This was just stuff that was used in highly technical research laboratories with rats and everything. There wasn't any practical way for your doctor to ever actually measure anybody's mitochondrial function. So it was no utilitarian purpose to know all this stuff. If you can't measure it, why talk about it? What we did is we took 50 subjects as they randomly presented to a number of clinics that use this testing procedure. These kids were all between 20 and 40 years old. They were all asymptomatic. They were, I call them health conscious, because they came to the clinics not because anything was wrong. They just wanted to see how healthy they were and what was the proper exercise zone for them and stuff like that. These were clinics that, in my clinic in Carson City, one down in Los Angeles, Grand Junction, Colorado, and Singapore. 54% of that group had normal mitochondrial function. 46% had abnormal mitochondrial function, less than 100% of predicted. 36% had less than 90% of predicted. 26% had less than 80% of predicted. 12% had less than 60% of predicted mitochondrial function. Now, if you go to the literature, you'll find out that those kids were eligible for disability. On disability guidelines for chronic fatigue syndrome, this is a criteria that can be used to get them disability. So this is, they have severe mitochondrial dysfunction, and yet they're walking around, they're talking, everything seems to be okay, no problem. We then noticed that only 24% of the subjects that had normal mitochondrial function had decreased fat metabolism. So about a quarter of the subjects with normal mitochondrial function were still, you know, if you remember that slide with the mitochondria, were still burning glucose just fine. They were effectively doing it. But when you looked at the subjects that had poor mitochondrial dysfunction, none of them was burning fat optimally, not single one. So you can see very vividly right here the connection between shifting from fat metabolism to glucose metabolism and how effectively your mitochondria can function. So what causes this? Now that you know why and how this kind of thing can cause cancer, promote cancer, make cancer more and more malignant, so what do you do about it? Well, what causes the fat to glucose shift is basically, one thing is insufficient fuel supply. So that means, you know, you've got to get fat into the cell and you've got to get glucose into the cell. If you can't get fat into the cell, what are you going to burn? You've got to burn glucose. You don't have a choice. So one of the things, perhaps the most important thing, especially in the younger age group, that causes this shift is an inability to get fat into the mitochondria. We call this impaired fat delivery. This is a classic of what you call metabolic syndrome. That's what metabolic syndrome is all about. You probably heard about that. It's what causes diabetes. It's metabolic syndrome, incidentally, is a bunch of other articles out recently about metabolic syndrome being much higher percentage in people that get cancer. Well, it shouldn't be too shocking right now for you to understand. But metabolic syndrome refers to an inability to get the fat from your fat stores into your bloodstream, through your bloodstream, into the cell, and finally into the mitochondria. There's a whole bunch of steps that are involved doing that. You need thyroid hormone to do that. You need cortisol hormone to do that. You need L-carnitine to do that. You need lipoic acid to do that. You need niacin to do that. And there's a lot of other cofactors that come to play here. But a lot of things go to get that fat from your fat cell down into that mitochondria. Anything that's impaired along that line impairs the delivery of fat to the cell. Cell has no choice now. It's got to burn glucose. So we will talk about this in some detail. What are the sorts of things that are involved in that? Because you don't want those things. You want your body to burn fat efficiently and not have to rely on glucose. One of the other things that can happen is a lack of the electron carrier coenzyme Q10. Coenzyme Q10 is involved in the first two steps of conversion of this energy, of this recharging your battery's energy. It's in the first two steps. It's a a critical enzyme, a rate-limiting enzyme in those two steps. Coenzyme Q10 is not much of an issue for younger people, but as you get to be 55, 60, 65, we routinely measure these levels and they start taking a crash bang. And it's very clear to me that that's one of the reasons why people in that age bracket that start hitting that 60, 65 thing, things don't start working so well, as often due to the fact that the coenzyme Q10 deficient. We'll talk about that in some detail. Of course, there's lack of oxygen. If you can't get oxygen in the mitochondria, you're going to work. Hold your breath. That's one good way to shift your metabolism to glucose. Just hold your breath. And we'll talk about the kinds of factors that can be involved in that will cause lack of oxygen to the mitochondria. We talked about ATP. That's your battery. That's what charges you. ATP, adenosine triphosphate, comes from AMP, adenosine monophosphate. And we'll talk about why it is that many of you may have decreased levels of adenosine monophosphate. Suffice it to say that without AMP, your mitochondria can't function at all. It's like a car without gas. Could be a really nice car. It's not going to work, do anything. And without AMP, that's your mitochondria aren't doing anything. So we'll talk about that. And then finally, this concept, excessive membrane leakage. We're talking about the mitochondrial membrane and protons leaking across the mitochondrial membrane. That's what mitochondrial leakage means. For you guys, it basically means toxicity. The mitochondria is breaking down. And so we'll talk about this concept of toxicity. These are the main things that are going to cause the mitochondrial dysfunction. So first of all, the glucose to fat shift. First of all, high dietary carbohydrate. I had a guy come in once. Patients teach you everything if you are lucky enough that you get some of these good experiences. I had a guy come in once. He's 42 years old. He's coming up from Los Angeles. He's a movie actor, which means he's got plenty of time on his hands. All he ever does, he's broke and he has plenty of time on his hands. Now, all he ever does is exercise. He goes to the gym and he exercises all day long. He looks like an Adonis. He's really a good guy. He feels great. He's a health conscious guy. He came all the way up from LA to get the test, and, see how it was going on. Well, he tested out horrible. His mitochondrial function is about 60% of the minimum. And my minimum is pretty bad. I mean, it's like, it's like a grading system on the curve, so to speak. It's real easy to do well on my test. When you don't do so well on my test, you're in trouble. The minimum I say is you got to do 100% predicted. Really, people that are really in good shape, 160%, 180%. That's what I mean, okay? So he's at 60% of predicted. So, what's up with that? He's a healthy guy. There's nothing wrong with him. He exercises all day long. He's a health nut. He eats sprouts and stuff. So, I got to talking to him, and what came out was he had told me, the only thing that might be a problem here is for the last 2 or 3 months, I've been eating a Dairy Queen Blizzard twice a day. And you guys know what that is? It's kind of a milkshake with Oreo cookies in them. Now, Oreo cookies have trans fatty acids in them. Trans fatty acids shut down mitochondria. That's published data. And plus, they're also loaded with sugar. So I asked him, why in the heck do you eat a Dairy Queen Blizzard twice a day? And he gave me the best possible answer you can give to that question. I like them. So I said, okay, I got a feeling this may be at the heart of your problem, because I'll be darned if I can figure out any other reason why you would have this problem. So why don't you just drop those for a while? And in fact, while you're at it, let's drop all the carbs, okay? No sugar of any kind, no fruit, no fruit juice, no root vegetables, like the old Atkins thing. And come back in like about 3 or 4 weeks. What's going to happen when you drop all those carbs is your body is going to be forced into going into fat metabolism. If all you're feeding it is fat and it ain't getting carbs, it doesn't have much of a choice. You're a healthy guy, you should shift right back over to fat metabolism. Let's see what happens when you do that. So he came back in about 3 weeks, we retested him. He's at 120% now. In 3 weeks, his mitochondrial function turned around that rapidly, and it's simply because he was eating too many of this. So what I have learned is a whole lot of those kids you saw on that last slide, it's mostly because they eat too many carbs. I mean, what can you have wrong with a kid? There's not too many things. So that's a lot of it. And this whole thing about, you know, cutting back on your carbs is so true. And I used to be a carb guy. I used to be one of those guys that said you should be a macrobiotic guy and you should never eat meat. That used to be me. Now I'm like 180 now, completely different, because of my work with mitochondria and seeing how these carbohydrates just toast your mitochondria. The other thing is, along with the high carbohydrate diet, we have the low fat diet. Again, it's just, if you want your body to burn fat, what should you feed it? Feed it fat. If you want it to burn glucose, feed it glucose. But probably after this lecture, you guys are going to be thinking, I don't think I want it to feed glucose so much. I don't want it to burn fat a little bit better. Then don't go on a low-fat diet. If you do anything, go on a moderately high-fat diet and a low-carbohydrate diet, and your body will start to shift this way. There's no exercise versus wrong exercise. One of the things I've discovered with my patients, we take exercise very seriously in my clinic. I don't just like, you know, say, oh, by the way, don't forget to exercise. You know, we drive you crazy with exercise. We tell you how you should exercise, what time of day you should exercise, why you should exercise, how it's going to look, what you're going to feel like, what your heart rate's supposed to be for this many minutes, what your heart rate's supposed to be. We just go crazy with it. Because what we've learned is that there's two kinds of people. One kind of people don't exercise at all. That's like most. Then there's 10% of the population that exercises all wrong. They do it too hard, and they're killing themselves. There's very few people that know how to get that little zone, get right in that little zone where the exercise is just doing great stuff for them and is not hurting them. So this no exercise part, and I kind of hinted at that a little bit earlier when I was talking to you about the study with the 7-year-olds, is very critical. If you exercise properly, you will train your body to burn fat beautifully. Hypothyroidism. Many of you here probably already know that there's no way in the world your doctor should ever diagnose a low thyroid state based on blood test. No way in the world. 99% of the time that you have a low thyroid, the blood test will be right in the normal range. So forget it. It's useless. Blood tests for thyroid are pretty good to diagnose excessive thyroid states. But to diagnose deficient thyroid states, they're not. Now you might say, well, why is that? It's the same reason so many other blood tests miss. Because in order to establish the reference range for blood tests, they go out into the general healthy population where nobody's low thyroid, because they all know that, right? And they establish the norms based upon that population. Well, I'm here to tell you, in that general population, better than half of them are low thyroid. So naturally, you're going to establish a range that misses low thyroid. When you do this kind of work, you can actually measure basal metabolism. The basal metabolism is 100% correlates with thyroid. So we're able to diagnose low thyroid states and with some real precision and sensitivity. And we very, very frequently notice at the same time the TSH, the free T4, and the free T3, all these measurements of thyroid function, are completely normal. And yet when we put our patient on the thyroid, dial them in so that their dose is appropriate and they start shifting over from glucose more to fat. Because remember, in order for you to burn fat, you absolutely need T3. You don't have T3, you don't do it. And so many of you don't have T3. I would tell you, based roughly speaking, over the age of 50, probably 85% of people need thyroid. Adrenal insufficiency, we measure this. You know, everybody has that, including yours truly. There's a lot of good stuff you can do for that, a lot of good herbs and hormones that you can take to help that. Anabolic hormone deficiencies, I'm 60 years old, I got that. So as you get older and you're going to, you know, get down on your estrogen, your progesterones, your DHEAs, your growth hormones, your testosterones, and all that kind of stuff. And all of those things, incidentally, make you burn fat better. So everything that's on this slide are things that help you to burn fat better. So as you go through that, you can say, no wonder people shift from fat to glucose. There's all these reasons to do that. And of course, deficiencies of carnitine. Where's carnitine? It's in animal protein. So if you're on a vegetarian diet, you don't eat much you don't eat much animal protein, you're going to be deficient on carnitine. There's a lot of published studies on people who are vegetarians, especially vegans, who have marked carnitine deficiencies. Lipoic acid, and there's some other nutrients that are pretty critical for fat metabolism if you're deficient on them. Just recently read an article on kids and obesity, one that was just published recently. one of the major causes for obesity that they're looking at for kids now is sleep deprivation. And now for us, this group, you know, we can get away with like 8 hours of sleep, maybe even a little bit less, and it'll be just fine. But kids, they need close to 10 hours, and they're not getting it. For whatever reason, they're not even close to getting that. And when they do that, when you don't get adequate sleep, it's pretty well demonstrated in the literature, you will not burn fat well. You will start shifting over to glucose metabolism. So that's part number one. Just to put it a little bit into perspective, I'm going to throw this one study in to show you. And this is 2004, April 2004. The title of the article is Dietary Carbohydrates and Breast Cancer Risk. And what they did is they looked at 49,000 Canadian women enrolled in the National Breast Cancer Screening Study. What they discovered is women in the highest quartile of high glycemic carbohydrate intake had almost twice the risk of breast cancer than those in the lowest quartile. You can start to understand why now. Because the higher glycemic, the less, the more they're shifting over to glucose, the less the mitochondrial function, and Warburg showed us that's what's going to cause cancer. So no wonder they had a higher incidence. The authors state, our data suggests that consumption of diets with high glycemic values may be associated with increased risk of breast cancer. Okay, now, the other thing that would tend to cause decreased mitochondrial function is coenzyme Q10 deficiency. As I said, it's not really common. I used to measure it all the time. Now I really don't measure it unless somebody's over the age of 60, because it's almost always normal. But over the age of 60, it's worthwhile looking at your CoQ10 levels. A healthy blood level would be over 100. Now, in the reference range, I believe, goes down all the way down to 70. I think the literature is pretty clear that 100 would be the minimum. Sinatra, in his book, The Sinatra Solution, has a lot of great references to CoQ10. It's an excellent book on mitochondrial function, by the way. Sinatra's a cardiologist that understands a very basic principle, that heart disease is more of a mitochondrial issue than it is a narrowing of the tubes issue. It's more of a mitochondrial issue. So his whole book is about improving the mitochondrial function in your heart cells. And you really should have in the order of like 150 on your L-carnitine blood, L-carnitine levels. And you really, for most people over the age of 55, 60, that means you got to take some L-carnitine. Statin medications, as you know probably, pretty much shut down the enzyme that makes coenzyme Q10. So if you're going to take these drugs, then I would suggest that you throw them out as fast as you can. But if you want to take statin drugs, at the very least, take a couple hundred milligrams of CoQ10, and you'll limit the toxicity from them. Okay, the third cause then was lack of oxygen. Now, you may think, well, geez, that's not very common, lack of oxygen. How could that be much of an issue? But actually, it's a lot more common than you think. Because when you start breaking down what will cause a lack of oxygen, first is the concept of anoxia. And that's normally what we think of as lack of oxygen, not getting, literally getting oxygen into your bloodstream. That could be caused by lung disease. But if you don't have lung disease, that could also be caused by just pollution. The ambient oxygen levels in metropolitan cities, you know, oxygen is supposed to be like 21% in the ambient air. And if you go to foresty areas, it's like 26%. You go into a lot of cities, it's 17%. So if you're living in that city, if you're living in that environment, walking down that street, you are in a state of anoxia. And you're going to have decreased mitochondrial function as a result of that. Certainly smoking will do this. Even passive cigarette smoking will do it. And inadequate breathing. And I haven't published anything on this, but what I found is I got very interested in yogic type of breathing. You guys know what that is? And you breathe from your diaphragm, kind of. And we did a few cases where we took people, measured their mitochondrial function, taught them how to do this breathing, remeasured it. Within days, they improved. So the fact is that when we're stressed out, we tend to breathe from the lungs and not from here, and we tend to have shallow breathing, and we're just not getting the same oxygen pool in that we would normally get. And it's a really good idea to get out your old yoga books and go back to class and kind of learn to breathe from your abdomen. Yeah, and I don't know if you heard this comment. He was learning exercise physiology, and his teachers were basically poo-poo this effect, the yogic breathing effect. I believe it works. And as an athlete, and I'm probably some other athletes in this room, I can tell you, I have beaten a lot of guys on the bicycle that were better than me because I breathed right. And I'm looking over at them, and I say, I can beat this guy. He can't breathe. Okay, ischemia. Now, that's not getting the oxygen in. Ischemia is you get the oxygen in. It's fine. Okay. But it doesn't get to the cell. Remember, it's got to go through those tubes. All the way down the capillary, it's got to get through all those tubes to get down to the cell. And guess what? Those tubes are jammed up. They don't work so well. This is a major cause. We see this all the time. I would have to tell you that this is probably the biggest single reason that we have decreased mitochondrial function, especially in the over 40 group, is ischemia. And that's why exercise is so huge, I think, because it just turns this around. Ischemia means that the blood vessels are clogged or they're constricted, or there's some impediment to the flow of blood. One of the reasons can be this called immune-stimulated activation to coagulation, or ISAC. This is very common. I won't get into a lot of detail here, but what this means when your body has inflammation, there's a lot of stuff out on inflammation nowadays, right? If you have an infection, if you have an inflammatory process such as arthritis, if you have allergies or anything like that, your body induces inflammation as part of its reaction to that. That inflammation causes your blood to start coagulating. Now, as a practitioner, we see this all the time because I do a treatment in my clinic where we take the blood, we phlebotomize blood out of the patient. We draw blood out of the patient, and we treat it and put the blood back in. The really sick people, and we have to heparinize that to stop them from clotting. The really sick people, I got to give them this much heparin. Healthy people, I got to give them that much heparin. And so we, can very vividly, if I don't give them this much heparin, they flat out clot. You can also see this under a dark field microscope. This is a very common condition. Inflammation causing your blood to clot prematurely. The clots jam up all the capillaries and the blood can't flow through and get ischemia. Extremely common. Atherosclerosis, of course, just, hardening the arteries. Endothelial dysfunction. A lot of people don't understand this concept. Endothelial cells are the cells that line the capillaries, all right? We tend to think of the capillaries as this is tube. It's a little plastic tube. And, blood's, it's not a plastic tube, though, really. It's cells. The cells are kind of grouped together but so that something can go through them, but it's just a bunch of cells. If those cells get sick or swollen, guess what happens to the capillary? It doesn't work so well. If those endothelial cells, the capillary cells, develop mitochondrial dysfunction, what happens? They don't work, and they swell up. So when they swell up, the capillary tends to get shut down, and blood can't get through. So this is a major, major issue right in here, and nitrous oxide deficiency, which also will induce endothelial cell swelling. Then there's always anemia. Sometimes patients have iron deficiency anemia. This should always be checked, just to sort of check your blood counts. If you don't have anemia, you have to do it. There's an enzyme called 2,3-DPG. 2,3-DPG is an enzyme that's formed in your cells that causes the hemoglobin to release the oxygen to the cell. But think of hemoglobin as being a pickup truck. It goes up to your lungs, it picks up the oxygen, it then cells and dumps it off the cell and get to work with it. What if the pickup truck didn't stop? What if it just kept on driving right by the cell, didn't drop off the oxygen? Well, you might as well be holding your breath. You got things driving all around, but you don't get the oxygen out of it. And that's what 2,3-DPG does. It's an enzyme that pushes the oxygen off the pickup truck, takes it off the hemoglobin molecule so that your cells can use it. Now, 2,3-DPG is very low in people who don't exercise. It's extremely low in people with diabetics. It gets lower and lower as you get older and older, and it's caused by oxidation, which is basically mitochondrial function. That's how you make 2,3-DPG. So it's a vicious cycle, kind of. The less mitochondrial function you have, less 2,3-DPG you get, less 2,3-DPG, less oxygen, less mitochondrial function. Antacids and other alkaline salts. One of the things that causes the hemoglobin to drop off the oxygen is acid. also, if you're taking a lot of antacids like Tums all day long, or anything else that's alkaline all day long, you're going to prevent oxygen from getting to your cells. So this is another issue that sometimes I see a lot and can be alkalinize your arterial blood and you won't release the oxygen. Yes. Most people think in physiology, and I'm not really prepared this time to argue this with you, but most people think in physiology the best water is slightly acidic. 6.8 is usually the pH they talk about. And I can make a real case for that. So we could talk about it later, but it's a little bit out of the realm of this talk. The other thing here, the next one is decreased AMP, adenosine monophosphate. Now, your body needs this to make adenosine triphosphate, which is your battery, okay? And you need to keep replenishing this. Where do you get adenosine monophosphate from? You get it through a process called methylation. That's where it's created. Methylation takes the amino acid methionine. It's a protein, okay? It takes a protein, pulls methyl groups off of it, and 80% of those methyl groups go to make this. So it's a pretty important process. People with poor methylation are sick across the board with any one of a number of things. And one of the reasons they are, if not the reason they are, is because they're going to have lower levels of AMP and hence decreased mitochondrial function. In order to have that process of methylation take place, you have to be eating protein. So if you're a person that has low levels of protein, if you're a vegan, you really should eat, and you not only have to have protein, but you have to have methionine. If you're a vegan, you really should be eating a fair, pretty good amount of soy, because soy is the only vegetable source of protein that has a significant amount of methionine in it. Other vegetable sources don't have as much methionine, and the less methionine you have, the less ability you will have to methylate. Even if you do have an adequate protein intake, though, you might not be able to methylate well. The process of methylation is like anything else. It can be very genetic. So, you know, some people do it really well, some people don't. Now, we can use this technology to measure how well you methylate. So I've learned a lot about methylation in the last 2 years by just measuring it in everybody. And surprise, surprise. Don't have any good numbers for you, but of the people that do the best almost across the board with mitochondrial function, they almost across the board are the best methylators. They show me some good process there. Yes. Well, you know, all I know is all this comes from methionine. So if you want to get the more methionine, he's asking, I believe you're asking, what sorts of proteins would improve methylation the best?
Well, the A is adenosine.
Yeah. No, we make adenosine monophosphate through this process of methylation.
Yes, but
it takes adenosine
and yeah. Phosphate.
Yeah, but the rate limiting step is not having enough adenosine around. It's being able to methylate the adenosine into adenosine monophosphate. That's the problem. Oh yeah, I see your question now. Yeah. To get more adenosine in, period. Okay, good point. That's a good point. Anybody understand that point? He's making the point that, in order for you to methylate the adenosine into adenosine monophosphate, you got to have methylation, but you got to have adenosine. You got to have some of the methylate. You get the adenosine from certain meat groups, and the point he was making is some people may need to eat different meat groups in order to get more adenosine. I don't really know this topic too much.
Dark
meats have more adenosine. Thank you. I learned that. That's great. Well, D-ribose also is a shortcut way to make AMP. It's a shortcut. So what Sinatra points out in his book is if you got somebody with heart disease, don't ding around with this. Just give them some D-ribose. It'll shortcut the AMP and get right to the main thing. And that really is true. So when we see patients that have very poor mitochondrial function, we'll start them on some D-ribose, give them a little bit of a jump start, maybe even keep them on that for a long time. Good point, yeah. Oh, the point was, if you don't methylate so well, one of the ways to get around that is just to take D-ribose. And a lot of people don't methylate that well, by the way, and that's just their genetic limitation. Autistic kids, for example, can't methylate at all. What I also want you to know is that mercury has been shown to shut down methylation, flat out shut it down. Secondly, in order to methylate, you must have, great limiting step, you must have folinic acid. Now, that comes from folic acid, but not a lot of people can, well, there are certainly, I think, like 30% of the population that has a problem converting folic acid to folinic acid. So it's a big problem with methylation. And lastly, you need B12, and you need not just any old kind of B12. There's three kinds of B12, cyano B12, hydroxy B12, and methyl B12. You must have methyl. And in order to get methyl, you have to make methyl. And if you can't make methyl B12, you better hope you're eating some in a vitamin pill or your doctor's giving you a shot of it. But see, these are the sorts of things you can enhance your methylation process with. Yes? All right, then I can't comment that on, but he's pointing out that a speaker made the statement that he was concerned that if you had a lot of mercury on board and you gave methyl B12, that somehow that would turn that mercury into methylmercury. And I guess that's possible, yeah. But I do want you to know that mercury is a major culprit in this, and of course you probably know by now we get a lot of exposure to mercury. Yes. Oh, you don't know what D-ribose is. All right, D-ribose is a sugar. It's naturally occurring, but it's not the kind of sugar that is sweet. Actually, it is a little bit sweet, but anyway, it's a nutraceutical. You go buy it in the health food store. And Sinatra's book talks a lot about it, and you probably a lot of stuff on the internet. You probably learn a lot. It's called D-ribose. Good sugar that will tend to bump up your AMP levels without the process of methylation. Yes. Yeah, it's a really good question. So he's asking, if antacids interfere with it. I would imagine there's a problem there because they're interfering with HCL production, and I know the acid production in your stomach has something to do with the acid-base equilibrium in your blood, but I can't answer the question. I've never studied it. You're taking a drug for if somebody's taking a drug to shut down acid production? Well, if you want to, you mean they take it for some other reason, like an antihistamine? Yeah. I guess you take some stomach acid, or probably what I try to figure out is what can I do to fix their allergy so they don't need the antihistamine. Well, I still got a little bit more, so maybe we... Okay, yeah, we'll do the question at the end. That way, anybody that doesn't want to listen to all this can go.
What about TMG?
All right, I'll come back to TMG. Save that. Yeah, he's got a good point here. Okay, so we're making AMP now, and we're eating lots of protein with methionine, and we're methylating like crazy. And of course, the other thing is, if you exercise, it stimulates the methylation shuttle. And then the last is this thing called excessive membrane leakage, and this is basically means toxicity. There's this membrane that is around your mitochondria. It's on the inner aspect of that membrane that all this stuff I'm talking about, where you take the oxygen and combine it with the fat, it all happens on that membrane. When that membrane breaks down, gets holes in it, so to speak, and protons start leaking around it, that's what this is, excessive membrane leakage. Now, you and I think of it as toxicity because when you look at all this stuff, this is where cyanide works. That's why cyanide kills you instantaneously. It shuts down your mitochondria like that, right now, by producing excessive membrane leakage. But what you may not know is NSAIDs do the same thing. Published data, NSAIDs produce electron chain leakage. Okay, you know what NSAIDs are? Celebrex, Vioxx, Motrin, Naprosyn, maybe even aspirin. So it's no real wonder that these things are associated with cardiac disease, for example. And they're going to be associated with a whole lot more. This is a real disaster brewing. I got no problem with somebody taking some, Motrin or something if they get a sprain and you need to calm it down for a week or so. No problem. But to take... No, the stuff's called NSAIDs. This stuff. Yeah. Yep. Incense. Yeah. It's a startling new revelation. The continuous persistent use, like Big Pharma would have you do, of taking your Celebrex every day of your life for the next 30 years, that's not a good idea. You can also develop membrane leakage through the interaction of the immune system with various viruses and bacteria. Cholic acid is a membrane toxin, a mitochondrial toxin. Now, cholic acid is formed in the liver from cholesterol. It's in your bile salts. So your bile salts secrete a lot of cholic acid. And now this, ideally in your intestines, when the bile secretes the cholic acid, you should have some fiber in there that will absorb the cholic acid and escort it out of the body. If you don't have fiber in your diet, then you won't escort the cholic acid out of your body. It'll go right back in your system, and you'll detoxify yourself and get higher levels of cholic acid, and it'll especially start injuring the liver. So that's why patients, incidentally, that have liver disorders, which I believe are all mitochondrial disorders, really benefit from a high-fiber diet. And that's sort of where Atkins was wrong. I believe Atkins was very right, but he was also wrong because he didn't really push the fiber. He took them off the carbs, but he didn't push the fiber. Cocaine will cause excessive membrane leakage, so you guys are going to have to cut back. Pesticides, the ones that are studied most in the literature are listed right there. Heavy metals, arsenic is well known, lead is well known to do this. Azides, which are in some fungicides. Cyanide, of course, chloroform, methamphetamine. Alcohol in large doses will create excessive membrane leakage. And some of the antiviral nucleoside analogs, including the anti-herpes ones that people take a lot, will cause membrane leakage. I'm almost at the end here. Diagnosing mitochondrial dysfunction and evaluating your mitochondrial therapy. So by now, probably you're pretty convinced, I hope, if I've done my job halfway reasonable, that you would really like to have very operative mitochondria. So how do you know if you do or not? You don't, unless you test. You got to get the test, folks. That's how you do it. There is a testing facility here in Lafayette, by the way. It's Health Medicine Institute. Probably you know these guys. They're over in Lafayette. Len Saputo is the MD over there. Really great group of people. And they're now doing this form of testing. So if you want to get the test, you can go to Health Medicine Institute in Lafayette. Or you can come up to my clinic if you want. That's fine, too. What the test does is it looks at ATP production because it's directly correlated with how much oxygen you utilize, and again, we're measuring that. It looks at whether you're burning fat or glucose, because whether you're burning fat or glucose depends not just on oxygen utilization, but how much carbon dioxide is made. You make twice as much carbon dioxide when you burn glucose as when you burn fat. So by measuring the ratio of carbon dioxide to oxygen, I know whether you're burning fat or glucose, or whether you're somewhere in between. Very simple. By the way, when you burn glucose, you get a lot more acid in your body, right? Because carbon dioxide is acid. You're making twice as much carbon dioxide when you burn glucose as when you burn fat. So the reason that we get acidic as we get older has got nothing really to do with our diet, only in as much as our diet influences mitochondrial function. And finally, we know when you get anaerobic because there's a sudden surge in CO2. So we can tell all this stuff from the data. For those of you who want to get a little bit more scientific on this thing, here's a thing called a webinar. So this is a seminar on the internet. It's real cool. We did one last January. It's about an hour and a half long. I go through a bunch of real technical slides and stuff for those that want to really see the biochemistry and biophysiology and stuff. You go to www.vrp.com/webinar/archive and just follow the instructions. You can get that. And you know, that's, yeah, yeah, that's sort of the topic, you know, and what we'll do is we'll take questions at this point. And I thank you for your attention. You've been a good audience. Appreciate it. He's asking if I have statistics, and sadly enough, I don't think any of us that work on the level I work on, you know, have statistics like that. It would be kind of unfair, because the truth is that I don't specialize in cancer. It's something I kind of do on the side, mostly for my patients, mostly as a service to my patients. These are tough conditions. And as you would expect, I only get the failed cases. I don't get anybody that just was diagnosed with cancer. Every now and then I get a case like that, and I relish it because I can really work on that. But mostly I get the people in that are exhausted mentally, emotionally, physically. They have stage 4 cancer. It's spread all over. They can't hardly walk. And what can you do for me, doc? So it's not really fair to even look at statistics in my situation. Yes?
Do you recommend coconut oil?
Ah, coconut oil. Judy. Coconut oil lady is right here. Coconut, yes, we do. And coconut oil is a very good source of fat. I'm not one of these guys that thinks saturated fat is bad. I think saturated fat is good, and I can make a good case for that. Coconut oil is a saturated fat, so I do like coconut oil. Everything needs to be in balance, but I love that stuff. Yes. Yeah, okay, that's a really good question, because that's one of my favorite topics. I do seminars for doctors, and one of the topics I do is on adrenal support, and I ask the doctors, do you know how you know when your patient needs adrenal support? And the answer is, they're in your clinic. All right. So if you walk into my clinic, by definition, you need adrenal support. No, but there's truth to that, because the truth is, as long as your adrenals are working great, you don't need the doctor. You know, everything's okay. You know, you're working, you can eat, you can sleep, you can get around, you can do this and that. As soon as they start to poop out, now you're a mess. So now it's time to go see the doctor. Now that's probably not true for you guys, because you're going to go in for preventive reasons, but 99% of patients, they don't go see the doctor until stuff goes wrong, and the stuff goes wrong when they're in their mind, when the adrenals are weak. What we do is, first of all, off carbs. Carbs will stress the adrenal, so we do an Atkins sort of thing. My variation on the Atkins is I really push the vegetables. I don't just say, don't eat carbs. I push the vegetables like crazy, so I'm going to eat a lot of vegetables. I want to get a lot of fiber, and I give them supplementary fiber addition. Then you look at, make sure they're getting enough sleep. And, you know, they're not all stressed out, so on and so on. But the big thing that we do is I make up a pill, and in that pill, each pill has 500 milligrams of adrenal extract, 500 milligrams of licorice extract. Licorice, yeah. The real licorice, not the deglycerinized licorice, because I want the glycerin in there, okay? 500 milligrams in each capsule. It's got 200 milligrams of adrenal extract, 200 milligrams of thyroid extract, 200 milligrams of, no, I couldn't have. It's got 150 milligrams each one of those, because it can't get more than 1,000 milligrams in a capsule. It's got 450 milligrams of licorice extract, 150 of adrenal, 150 of thyroid, 150 of liver, 350 of pantothenic acid, and 3 milligrams of DHEA. Okay? It's a pretty powerful little pill. I give them four of those in the morning and four at 2 p.m. Okay, a whole lot. And in addition to that, I very frequently will give them hydrocortisone. Hydrocortisone is the hormone cortisol, by the way. So there's different words for the same thing. And you can, that's a pharmaceutical. You have to, you know, get, it's a prescription-only type thing. But I give them hydrocortisone anywhere from 5 to usually 10, 5 to 10, twice a day, morning and 2 p.m. So you stopped it and you're still doing that?
Yeah.
Still falling asleep after you eat? You know, I don't know. Sounds like low blood sugar to me, so I don't know why that is, though. Yes? Well, yeah. You know, teenagers are, keep in mind, kids are like really in a different phase than we're in. They're in this expansive phase, okay? And so they can suck up all that glucose pretty well as a rule. And they can tolerate glucose, dietary glucose a whole lot better than the rest of us can. And yeah, and they can typically metabolize that and get away with it better than you and I can get away with it. But there's a limit. And you can clearly see with the incidence of diabetes in children, and the incidence of obesity in children, that there's obviously a limit to what they can do. I'm sorry? Trap? Oh, fat metabolism. Well, fructose has to be broken down into sucrose in the liver. And if you take too much of it, you're not going to be able to do that. And then you're going to have a lot of fructose accumulating in the liver, and it's going to create its own pathology. Yes? $200 in my clinic. I don't know what HMI is charging. Yes. And they're insurance reimbursable, by the way. Ah, good question. So how do I treat mercury? The first thing to do is to see if you have it. So the way I do it is I give you a 50 milligram pill, I believe it's 50 milligrams, of DMPS, which is a mercury chelator, potent chelator. I check your urine before and 2 hours later. Look at the difference and see how much mercury you pulled out. You cannot do a hair analysis. You cannot do just a standard urine or a standard blood to diagnose a heavy metal. You literally have to do what we call a provocation study, where you put something into your system that will pull that metal out and then measure how much comes out. Typically speaking, most of us will bring out something less than, I don't know what the units are, it's probably five nanograms per deciliter. I don't really know what the unit is, but on my test, you'd be producing less than five. If you're producing over five, and particularly we see people that, like dental hygienists and such, that produce 120, you know that they have, you know, a severe body burden of mercury. Problem is, when you do heavy metals, it's not just about how much heavy metal you have in, it's about what your genetics are like, because some of us are a lot more susceptible to that metal than the others are. So even if you have relatively low amount of that metal in, doesn't mean it's not causing you more problem than the next guy that has more metal. How do you flush it out? Okay, for mercury, I go with DMSA, and I'll give 500 milligrams of DMSA three times a week, and that pretty much always works. It'll take months now. Now we're getting down and personal. Okay, typical day. Half hour exercise in the morning, and I do interval training, which means I'm pushing my heart rate. When you do this kind of test, you know where your heart rates are where you become anaerobic. You know where your heart rates are for maximum fat burning. You know, and based upon those heart rates, you can design a program where you do a blast of exercise, get your heart rate anaerobic, then you come back down and let it coast with just a little bit of exercise like this. And so you're floating right at your fat burning level until you fully recoverize, and then bang, you do another blast. So I do an exercise like that for 30 minutes. I make a shake up. It's called Quick Start. What it has, it's got a lot of spirulina in it. It's got a lot of vitamins and minerals and antioxidants, a whole lot of protein, a lot of fiber and stuff like that. And you can mix that in with some water, and I take that. So that's my breakfast. I usually put an extra scoop of egg protein powder in there. That's my breakfast. I believe in not eating. I think it's really good not to have 3 square meals a day. So I've got a whole program around that where you only eat 1 meal a day, and that's what I do, mostly. But of course, I switch up every now and then. At noontime, I will have some organic V8 or vegetable juice, and I'll throw in a bunch of free-form branched chain aminos, about 10 grams of those in there. That's lunch. That's lunch. V8 with free-form amino acids thrown in there. You guys haven't tried this stuff. It's pretty good. You'll think you just had a Starbucks or something. About a half hour later, it's pretty neat. I'm not into eating except 1 meal a day. Why? When you're starving, what's your body going to do? It's going to shift right over to fat burning. Absolutely. And it will stimulate lots of growth hormones while you're at it. Who is it? Walter. Yeah, so it's basically a calorie restriction program is what it comes down to. But it has all these other little benefits. And I'm a real believer that the two major causes of diseases in our society is 1, eating too many carbohydrates, and 2, eating. So we cut down on both. And I'm a low adrenal guy. I need lots of adrenals. So I have a whole pile of adrenals in the morning and a whole another pile. At 2 p.m. I'll have some more of that powder I was telling you about, the green powder, with some protein and a whole bunch of adrenals. And when supper comes around, then I'll go to town and do what I want to do. I try to get at least 8 hours of sleep. That's basically what I do. It's called Quick Start. Can they get it through the internet? Yeah. I think if you go to bioenergytesting.com, my book describes it, by the way. If you have one of the books, it'll describe and tell you what's in it. I'm obviously biased. I made it, so of course I think it's good. But the truth is that it, in terms of clinical results with my patients, it exceeds what I thought it would do. Stuff is really good. But it's just a powder, and it's a way of getting protein, fiber, and all kinds of nutrition and such, and one thing that doesn't taste too bad. And you can learn about it at bioenergytesting.com, and you can even order it through that site if you want to try it out. Typical dinner is going to be meat and vegetables and a salad. Yes. Great. I mean, what I do is like 1 meal a day. It's like, a 24-hour fast every day. But yeah, I love fasting. I don't like prolonged fasts. I think as soon as you start going over 3 days, you start actually reducing your growth hormone output. So I don't like that so much. The long fasts are good for really sick people, but for healthy people that just want to have that fasting benefit, don't do it more than a couple few days. And for me, I just try to do it every day for 24 hours and then break it. He's mentioning that he read a study where the gist of the study was, or the conclusion of the researchers was, that animal protein is what caused cancer. Oh, and there's a book, and that's one of the conclusions they reach in there. Excessive animal protein causes cancer. You know, the problem with these studies is, in my opinion, a diet excessive in protein is going to be maybe deficient in fiber, and maybe deficient in nutrients. So maybe it's not a fair comparison. I really don't like these population studies. And one of the reasons I don't like them is because anything I want to prove, if I want to prove meat's good, if I want to prove meat's bad, if I want to prove tomatoes are good or tomatoes are bad, I'm going to find a study to prove that. So I really don't like them. I'd much rather have a prospective study where they take a group of people and they, you know, do some measurements, divide them in half. This one eats a whole bunch of meat, this one doesn't, and then they say exactly how much they eat, and then they tell me what happens. And so, I don't know. I haven't read that book, though. I've heard about it, but I haven't read it.
The other question, it seems like I read some articles about NSAIDs having some cancer protective effect.
You know, no, I haven't. He was mentioning that he read an article where he thought NSAIDs had a cancer protective effect. I'm not saying NSAIDs cause cancer here, by the way. I'm just simply saying that NSAIDs, it's in the literature that NSAIDs will produce proton leakage across the mitochondrial membrane, and that will cause some other things that you now know about. And it sounds very suspicious for the use of them. NSAIDs will reduce inflammatory markers, on the other hand. Inflammation is what causes decreased circulation to a large extent, so maybe they outdo it by getting more oxygen down there. I don't know. All right, well, thanks a lot, you guys. Have a nice evening. Drive safe.
Just one thing. Please pay your dues. We haven't been good at collecting dues. Only about 2 out of 3 people have paid their dues.
So we have some kind of chronic infection. The body sequesters the copper, puts it into ceruloplasmin, so it's not available to the body, and therefore you can have substandard collagen maturation, which can then, over the long term, result in joint degradation.
Thanks, Steve. By the way, we missed you last night.
Hyaluronic acid helped my joint problems significantly and quickly. But I found some brands work like a miracle and some don't do anything at all. And I can't tell what the difference is between brands. So,
which work like miracle?
Now, by the way, we're just throwing stuff out here. Now, the procedure is, for those of you who are new, you go on the web and you find out what the research is behind it. I mean, this is not just like time for testifying. This is time to give people leads so they can do some research, right? So, you can go on the web and find out what the science is behind it and what the clinical experience is behind it.
What are the sites you try?
Well, I would put the word in, like hyaluronic acid, plus, for example, collagen or cartilage. What?
Or joint.
Or joint, or yeah, knee. Plus joint. So I would try that. And it's amazing how good it is. Also, by the way, if you can't find anything on Google straight away and you want to go to the articles themselves and look at the abstracts. If you put in scholar.google.com, scholar, S-C-H-O-L-A-R, scholar, then you'll get the research itself. They'll give you the report and they'll tell you how often the article is cited. You can kind of find out what articles are there where there's taken to be defining on the subject, to some extent by how many citations that the article has in the literature. And you can read the abstracts. The abstracts are only, you know, half a page long. So you read 4 or 5 abstracts and you start to get an idea of what's going on. So let me get to friend.
Hi, I just had two questions. One for Steve. If you wear copper, does that work?
Yes.
It does. And then for the lady at the front desk, I didn't hear what you were saying about cartilage?
if you have any cartilage left, unflavored Knox gelatin, if you put it in your, either your juice or water, stick it in the refrigerator for a minute, and mix it up, and you take that every day, it's going to grow your cartilage back. With vitamin C, it will grow it back. My problem was I didn't have any cartilage left. The doctors took it all out.
Thank you, Colonel. Let's see how long we get Leslie here.
Hi. Does anyone know the information about coconut oil? I've been reading about coconut oil in a good positive light. And also inositol for obsessive compulsive behaviors.
Coconut's
we get two questions, right?
Let's do coconut oil here.
Okay.
Thank you. I've read all of Bruce Fife's books, and I've sold over 100 of his books and a lot of coconut oil, and I've used it not only for myself, but my pets. The coconut oil you can use externally and internally. You can use it for your skin, for your hemorrhoids. You can use it for pest parasites. True story, your hair, conditioning your hair. There's 1,000 uses of the coconut oil. And the best book that I found that he's got is The Coconut Cure. It's a fabulous book. He also has coconut books, a book out with recipes. And he's really done a lot of research. I talked to him personally. He's a fabulous guy. And I love all his books, and I love his products. The only thing I have to say is please don't take the coconut oil past 3 or 4 o'clock, because I took it at 5, 6 o'clock one night, a teaspoon, by mouth in the morning and the evening, and I was buzzing till 6 o'clock the next day. It gives you a lot of energy. I mean, it gives you a lot of energy, and you feel good, and it also stops the pain. So there's thousands of uses for the coconut oil. Get the book, it's fabulous.
What is the book?
The Coconut Cure by Bruce Fife. Fabulous book.
F-I-F-E.
Yeah, let me tell you a little story about Smart Life Forum and coconut oil. When I first got into the Smart Life Forum in the early days, and Catherine Gross was the, our founder was the president, and the two people that were most memorable in those early days that I can remember was John Lee, who later became famous as the man who put natural progesterone on the map and, you know, really changed female hormone replacement across the whole country. And if you haven't seen his books, I would definitely look them up. But the other guy that was famous in those early days and who we had here, we had John Lee here a couple times, and we also had another fellow by the name of Ray Pete. And Ray Pete, one of his favorite subjects is coconut oil. He's a brilliant biochemist, and if you want to get some research on coconut oil, then I would put in Ray Pete plus coconut oil and read some of his stuff on it. And some of the things that Pam said that seem outrageous will begin to seem, you know, sensible, because you'll begin to understand the biochemistry involved. But Catherine was so taken with this, and we were all so taken with this, she ordered a drum of coconut oil, which turned out to be a major problem because it was really heavy, and she had to get it home. And then she would scoop it out and put it in jars, and I still have some. Those early days, because I don't cook. So I don't know. But the thing is, it doesn't go rancid. It's crazy. So and you know, we were all really up on coconut oil. Remember that, Steve? And I don't know, anybody else have any of that old coconut oil around?
Yeah.
So you know, you gotta take coconut oil seriously, and there's great biochemistry behind it. Okay, let's see another comment. We gotta stop here pretty soon. Let's we get to
No, I just want to say that she didn't realize what 55 gallons of oil looked like.
Yeah, right.
She stuffed it on her front driveway.
Yeah, I don't know how she ever got it in the house.
Yeah, I hear people who are really into it, they'll be doing 2 and 3 tablespoons a day. I mean, I think you just take it and scoop it on down. And one person, I think even at the last meeting, I said that they lost 30 pounds in a very short period of time. Because it's the old story that fat burns fat. People forget that. The more fat, the better. You know, as long as they're good fats. The omega-3s and so forth, the coconut oils, fish oil, I take them all together at the same time with my organic butter. And as long as I've got the mic, let me give a quick plug for Smart Life Forum. Tonight's the first night I brought most of the videos I've shot, and I think I'm up to almost I think this will be 61 videos I've shot over the last 5 years. So if there's a subject, including hyaluronic acid, it might just be in my files over there. If it isn't, you can order it online. And we hope in the future to have all of them available, downloadable form on our website as time progresses. Okay, so just keep your hopes up. That was about Jake Mata and I to say. So the list of all the videos are here, and we can get last month's and several other months right there. Dr. Sandy at the end of the table. Thanks.
What about inositol? Anybody know that?
Okay, I'll tell you what, let's do that as the last project, and then we'll go to our short work. Inositol, especially for obsessive compulsive disorder, right? That's the, okay, I know one person who knows about that, because he knows all this kind of stuff, but who else? Anybody else before you go over and ask Steve?
What's the name of it? What is the name of it you're talking about?
Inositol.
Inositol.
It's a nutrient.
Yeah, now let's see. How do you spell that one? I should.
I-N-O-S-I-T-O-L.
What is it? Who can spell
it? I-N-O-S-I-T-O-L.
I think it's
I-N-O-S-I-T-O-L.
Oh,
That's good.
Don't worry.
When I was young, I could visualize all those words and I'd come back and go, I can't do it anymore. I'm sorry. Okay, let me ask Steve what he thinks about that.
I can't address the question of inositol directly, but I do know that one of the mechanisms involved in OCD has to do with dopamine dominance in the brain, and the more dopamine you have in your brain, the more obsessive and compulsive you tend to be, the more irritable and the more driven you are. But the way in which I think the most common factor that influences that is that the balancing neurohormone, serotonin, is low. And so when your serotonin is on the other side of the teeter-totter from the dopamine, if the serotonin goes down, the teeter-totter tips and the OCD acts up. And the most common, there are OCD factors relating to genetics and development, which, you know, that's something that happens. There's not a lot you can do about it. But a lot of late developing OCD and sudden onset OCD has to do with the immune system. As I mentioned before, with copper being sequestered as a result of immune system activity, serotonin is produced from tryptophan, which is burned up when your immune system goes into high drive. So your immune system turns on, your white blood cells crank out cytokines, activate a series of enzymes, one of which is called indolamine dioxygenase, which is abbreviated IDO, and its job is to burn up tryptophan and 5-hydroxytryptophan, which are the natural precursors for serotonin. So when your inflammatory system goes up, your serotonin goes down. And this is why, how many have had kids who, when they run high fevers, are, you know, tossing and turning all night and having nightmares and this kind of stuff? That's a manifestation of low serotonin.
Why is it...
It's a defense mechanism. It turns out that tryptophan is one of four major growth factors for bacteria and parasites in the bloodstream. And so tryptophan levels are the rate-limiting step. And so when you get your immune system turned on, they drop by 50% in about 2 hours and stay down for the duration of the infection. And that's to keep the bug from growing so that your immune system can win the war against it.
So taking more tryptophan gets rid of the bugs.
No,
all the way around.
Makes them bloom.
Right. Yeah, but if you don't have an infection and you have OCD, then you might want to try serotonin. I mean, as a matter of fact, it's pretty well known that serotonin works pretty well for a lot of OCD. Okay, I think I'm going to stop right there. Okay, wait a minute, Larry, you want to
see? Yeah.
Look up a book called The Mood Cure Diet by Julia Ross. She's a psychologist who treats, she chooses amino acids for therapy, and I think that would address what you're curious about.
Yeah, and also the website for that is moodcure.com or dietcure.com. And I want to give a plug to Bill Grant, who did the foreword in this wonderful book on vitamin D. Bill, where are you? There he is. Okay. You can talk to Bill, and the book's available.
Right, 25 bucks.
Terrific compilation of excellent vitamin D.
Yeah. Okay, give the money to Pam, and she'll give it to Bill. Okay, now let's see. Let me just check and see how we're doing here on our agenda. Okay, oh, one other thing I wanted to mention. You know, Bruce Ames gave a wonderful talk last month when he was asked what the dosage was for alpha lipoic acid and acetyl-L-carnitine. He said, see the website. And that wasn't completely helpful, so I wanted to just tell you that my understanding of the research that they did, they did the research on rats originally, and that's the research that was published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Science, which article you can easily find on the internet. And they got this tremendous results that if you use the combination of alpha-lipoic acid and acetyl-L-carnitine, you will improve mitochondrial energy very dramatically, especially if you're older. If you're young and you don't have any deficiencies in those things, you don't see much difference. But you know, as you get older, that's one of the things that starts to decline, and that's why we have less enthusiasm than we did when we were teenagers, when we're 70. But you can change that quite easily, as Bruce Ames and his associates discovered. Now, what's the dosage? I think the dosage is something like this. Steve can correct me, but it's something like they used R-lipoic acid, by the way, which is this very kind of expensive version. And I think they used about a gram or a gram and a half a day. What would it, if you prorate up, if you extrapolate to human size as opposed to rats, a gram or a gram and a half of alpha-lipoic and about 2 or 2.5 grams of acetyl-L-carnitine, is that about right, Steve?
I think that probably scales about correctly, except that their initial results were not with the R-lipoic acid.
Well, they weren't. Okay, well, that's good. That's interesting. Because it makes sense that if you use racemic, it'd be that much. I don't think you need that much alpha-lipoic myself. That's why I really hesitated. I take 200 milligrams of R-lipoic acid, which is there's, you know, a lot of molecules you know are right-handed and left-handed, and just one of them is active in the body and the other is kind of in the way sometimes. And that's the case. Racemic is the mixed one, where you get both left and right-handed lipoic acid. If you want to get just the active one, you get the R. Now, right back to you, Dave. So I think if you take 200 milligrams of alpha-lipoic acid R twice a day with 2 or 3 500 milligram capsules of ALC, you'll get the result. And you'll notice it right away. It doesn't take long. You'll notice it by probably the first day, at least the second day. And if you take a little biotin with it, which is easy to get in most multivitamins, there's no known adverse consequences. And if you don't take the biotin, you get a little rash, I guess, if you're 1 in 200 people. So let me see what Dave has to say.
Hi, I run a group on Yahoo called Rejuvenate, where the main topic of discussion is alpha-lipoic acid and acetyl-L-carnitine. There's a bunch of various types of experts. I don't think Bruce Ames is on there. He isn't a common poster. But there are various theories about what the right amounts are. But if you wanted to read more, we have a history of all the postings, all the questions, all the answers. But I think it depends a lot on what you need. One thing I've heard is that adding astaxanthin, one of the sort of exotic antioxidants, to a high dose ALA regimen can reduce the rash and some others. One guy has some joint effects that he seemed to think went away when he took that. But whether they're really caused by ALA, ALC, I don't really know. Yeah. You know, it's hard to say.
Yeah, okay.
What's the size?
And by the way, the rash isn't that common. Bruce said it's 1 in 200 people. And let me see, one other thing that triggered something.
I should say this slide one more time. Go to yahoo.com, click on groups, and then look for Rejuvenate inside there. That's the name of the Yahoo group, so it's part of Yahoo.
There's one other tip, which is on the sheet, by the way. If you pick up the thing on the 10 supplements, One of the 10 is the ALC combo, and you'll see this dosage. And the tip there is that a lot of times, if you take that much, you know, for example, 1,500 milligrams of ALC at once with the help of the book, you can kind of upset your tummy a little bit. It can, you know, you feel a little bit uncomfortable. I guess I think maybe it makes this stomach too acidic. I'm not sure what's going on. But anyway, I guess it must be because the remedy is to take about an eighth of a teaspoon of baking soda and put it in a half a glass of water and stir it up and drink it, and then your tummy feels fine again in about 2 minutes. So anyway, but this is one of the real breakthroughs in biochemistry. All of you should check it out because it's one of the most dramatic things you can do for yourself. Yeah, Ray.
Well, I immediately.
Made use of the coupons that we got.
Yeah.
And ordered, you know, several bottles at 50% with the formula that has everything in it, biotin, the L-carnitine, and so forth. Now, I don't remember the exact amounts. I'm taking one, it actually recommends two a day. I have a bottle in the car if anybody's interested in the actual dosage. They're recommending two a day, either the two with a meal or, you know, one in the morning and then one later on. But my recollection, I believe that each tablet is 500 milligrams of the folic acid with the L-carnitine. So that, in which case, if the recommendation is two, it would be 1 gram, it would be 1,000 milligrams.
Yeah.
If anybody's interested, I'd be more than glad to go to the car and then get the actual, you know.
Yeah, that seems odd to me, but you know, Steve and I went up and heard Hussein's report on this about 4 years ago, before when the article was in publication, and I wrote down the formula then, and you know, that's the formula that I just gave you. Let me see, there's something else I want to say about that. Sorry, you lose me. Okay, Cordell.
So a few months ago, one of the speakers talked about the R form. And there's different ways to make it. And one of the ways that was out said it polymerizes into a sticky substance that can't be absorbed. So I went home and looked inside, and sure enough, the R form that I had was in some sticky, glutinous mass. So I can't remember what the name of the super-duper form was. You may know.
I think you can go do Genova Research, G-E-N, Genova Research.
They're still using the R-L.
Oh, they are? Oh.
Yeah, they are. They have, what Bruce said is he hadn't moved to the other one.
Oh.
Because there's some uncertainty.
Here's something I picked up after you all left, that Bruce left a bunch of these coupons. If anybody wants them, just help yourself. Okay, let me introduce Don Southard, who introduced our short report. By Richard, this is out. Well, wait a minute. Pam, do you want to? We better get. Excuse me, Dad. Let me sister Pam first. You want to? Here, bring this over. Bring this over, Pam.
Tonight, I'd like to talk about the letter that I got, and I'm sure a lot of you got from Dr. Johnson, right? It's wanted your doctor. This is all about. It talks all about the natural remedies that the doctors are doing and they're using to help heal you. And all these good doctors, they're losing their licenses, they're pulling them out of practice. There's cases in here that people, juvenile kids who had chemo, and the states have forced them into doing it. So what I'd like to do is, I've made copies here, I'd like everybody to come and sign this, mail it in and send it to Governor Schwarzenegger. But what I would like to do is go over a couple quick cases real quick. There was a 15-year-old boy that had Hodgkin's disease. It's a rare form of lymphoma. The doctors recommended that he does chemo. So he went and did his chemo the first time, and the cancer was still there. They recommended he did it the second time, the cancer was still there. So at that point, the parents and the boy, Alhambra, did not want to go any further. So they were talking to the reporters, and they said, the chemo is going to kill me. I don't want to do any more. My parents and I discussed to go to Mexico and try some natural alternatives. All of a sudden, the social worker from the state courts came in, and they drug the parents in court, and they said that if he did not do his chemo, they were going to pull the son from the parents and take custody of the son, Alhambra, and he had to do the chemo. So they had a lengthy court hearing, and it just kept dragging on and on. And finally, this is true stories, and finally, the courts allowed him to go ahead with his choice, but only on the one condition that he absits that he submits to conventional radiation therapy. Then there was a case about a 12-year-old girl in Texas. She had cancer too, and her parents just flat refused to do any kind of chemo. The state came in and took the girl away from the parents, and because the parents were using natural remedies, vitamins and herbs and supplements, they also took her two healthy brothers away from the parents too. Now this is all in Jonathan Wright's letter that came to me. It's on his website, and I also want you to know yours truly, Jonathan Wright, is being attacked too on his website. So then there was a Dr. Rothstein who did alternative medicine. This guy had a fabulous record, no complaints, no problems, and all of a sudden the Maryland Board of Physicians came in and pulled his license permanently. So this letter that I'm asking everybody to sign is going to help, hopefully it's going to help, and I want everybody to support it if possible, because we are being denied the treatment that we want and being forced into the treatment that we don't want, and so are our families. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Pam.
Do you know if any of these cases have occurred in California? I've asked specifically because both the dental board and the medical board have been terminated in California due to this kind of political machination. And so I'm just wondering if they still have the gumption to do anything like that in California.
Well, I can tell you this. With the cases that I talked about, one is in Texas, one is back east. But I do know of a doctor who did natural products, who is a friend of my niece's, who works for Boeing Airlines. And my niece's best girlfriend's father is in jail for 10 years because he practiced homeopath in Los Angeles a year and a half ago.
Was he a homeopath?
He did all natural homeopath. So he's in jail. He was stripped of everything. Everything. They raided his whole office and took everything away from him.
California is, I think, better off at least because there is a law which was passed in the last 5-7 years, kind of a health freedom law, which says that if you don't do anything invasive, then you can, you don't have to be an MD to do that kind of medicine, to do nutritional medicine and so forth. And so to some extent, doctors and people like us, of course, I guess we're protected by the First Amendment, because we're not doing it for money. But I'm a great admirer of Jonathan Wright, and he's a brilliant doctor, man of total integrity, and a real pioneer in biochemical medicine, biomolecular medicine. And when I got my renewal, I got that letter before I heard from Pam. I sent it off to Governor Schwarzenegger. I don't know exactly what the status of things are in California, but I think it's a good idea. It's easy enough to do it. Okay, now let me introduce Don. Sorry, Don.
Thank you, Phil. We have a great treat with us tonight. We have Richard Niesenbaum, who I'll describe in just a moment. But, you know, basically talking about injustices, when President Hugo Chavez came to the United Nations a few weeks ago, as you remember, he opened it up by blessing himself in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, and you know this, and I said, what a wonderful religious individual this man is. Because I spent so many years of my life on my knees in a very cold church because they would not allow we young fellas to sit in the pews. That was for the older pukes. The younger pukes had to be on their knees on the cold bricks. And And I went through the name of the Father, Son, the Holy Ghost, and I kept asking the sisters, the brothers, and the fathers, I said, sister, what is a Holy Ghost? And they said, Mr. Southern, you step up here and put out your hand. And I'd step up there. You don't know who the Holy Ghost is. I know Sister Sulica. And so the ruler would come down on my hand, okay? So after Chavez made this statement in front of the United Nations, I said to my wife, I said, honey, I said, who is the Holy Ghost? She says, there's no Holy Ghost. I said, what do you mean there's no Holy Ghost? She says, they abandoned that 25 years ago. It's now the Holy Spirit in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. I said, for 2,000 years there's been a Holy Ghost. And I said, my hand has been swatted so many times from asking everybody what is a Holy Ghost, and now it's a Holy Spirit. So again, this is the sort of injustice that you're talking about. And we're witnessing it right here in River City. Now, yes.
What's the Holy Spirit?
I don't know. Nobody knows who the Holy Spirit is. And I would also say that probably one of the injustices that poor Dr. Bob Cathcart gave us a wonderful talk last week. And last month, and the wonderful talk, because we have some of the people in this room are the tidal backwashers of society, as you know, Dr. Bob, and I don't think it did them much good, unfortunately. And so.